students, I am Tulika Banerjee. Today, I bring you the next learning episode in BSc Forensic Science on an important unit of the paper titled Fingerprints, that is, Physical Method for Detection of Latent Fingerprints, that is, Powder Method. In this lecture, you will be studying about the physical method of latent fingerprint detection and its historical perspective. In addition to it, you will also be studying about mechanism of technique, application procedures, regular powders and metallic powders. We will wind up this module with a conclusion. So, let's start our today's lecture with a brief look at what we will be learning today. First is introduction to physical method. Then we have historical perspective. Next is mechanism of technique. The fourth one is application procedures. Then we have regular powders, metallic powders, and lastly the conclusion. So, dear students, let's begin our today's lecture with the introduction to physical methods. Fingerprints are the distinctive ridges appearing as corrugated lines on the tips of fingers and thumbs. The corrugation results due to rising of a portion of the upper layer of the fingertip skin slightly above the normal level. Since the upper layer of skin is called as epidermis, the finger ridges are also referred to as epidermal ridges. The pattern on each finger of a person is so unique that it is not repeated on another finger of the same person or on the fingers of any other person. This makes fingerprints the most infallible means of identification. This identification mark of an individual is used as an investigative tool in criminal cases. Latent prints are mostly encountered at the scene of crime. The investigators use the general technique of oblique lighting to locate these latent finger marks. After locating these prints, certain physical and chemical techniques are required for their development. The physical method comprises the use of various types of powders. The powder technique for detecting latent fingerprints involves the application of a finely divided formulation to the finger mark impression, generally using a glass fiber or a camel hair brush. The powder gets mechanically adhered to the sweat residue, defining the ridge pattern. The furrows, which are devoid of the fingerprint residue, do not adhere the powder onto them. The final outcome is that the powder formulation sticks to the ridges but is easily blown off the furrows. Since the powder is normally colored, the ridge pattern becomes visible and the latent print is said to have developed. The use of fingerprint powders dates back to the last decade of the 19th century. Sir Edward Richard Henry from 1850 to 1931, who devised the fingerprint classification formula, recommended the use of mercury-based and graphite-based powders. The former formulation, called as hydrogyrum concreta, was composed of one part of mercury and two parts of chalk by weight. The powder was suitable for developing latent prints on non-absorbent surfaces such as glass and dark painted or lacquered utilities. However, the formulation was withdrawn in the year 1967 because the mercury content could be a health hazard. Moreover, it was ineffective for developing prints on gold ornaments as mercury reacted with gold and marred its surface. The graphite-based powder was very useful for developing imprints on silver-painted objects. However, even this powder was withdrawn since it was messy to use, particularly if the examination was to be carried out in open and a strong wind was blowing. Today, there are a number of powders which are available in market required for the purpose of detection of latent fingerprints. Depending on the surface color and texture, these powders can be applied easily. The various types of powders which are available comprise of black powders, magnetic and non-magnetic powders, fluorescent powders. All of these powders work on the same mechanism. So with this in mind, today in this lecture, you will also study about the basic mechanism on which this powder technique works. So our next module is on the mechanism of technique. The application of finely divided material and the subsequent removal of the excess powder by brushing, blowing or tapping has been the universal method of intensifying fingerprints on non-absorbent surfaces since the early days of fingerprint technology. The technique relies on the mechanical adherence of fingerprint powder to the moisture and oily components of the skin rich deposit. This figure shown on your screen shows the different hue and shades kit containing fingerprint powders. The adhesion of powder formulation to fingerprint residue is governed by the pressure deficit mechanism. If a powder particle is wetted only on its lower side by the sweat deposition, then owing to the curvature of meniscus, there will be a pressure deficit inside the droplet, causing the particulate to adhere or stick. The electrostatic attraction between the sweat residue and the powder particles resulting due to frictional charges also play a major role in adhesion, albeit a minor one. The effectiveness with the powder adheres to the ridges depends on the size and shape of the particles that compose the formulation, that is, the formulation of the powder. Small, fine particles adhere more easily than large, coarse ones. Therefore, most formulations are composed either of very fine, rounded particles about 1 micrometer in diameter or of fine flake particles about 10 micrometer in diameter. Nanoparticle size powder compositions have proved to be very effective in lifting fingerprints. A sample fingerprint developed with the aid of a nanoparticle based composition incorporating crystal violet stain or crystal violet dye is depicted in this image as has been shown on this screen. As the age of the fingerprint residue increases, the moisture and oily components tend to evaporate, leaving the deposition more viscous. The same phenomenon is observed in warm climates also. Thus, aged prints in tropical climates are relatively difficult to develop by powder technique or powder method. The drying rate, however, is not dependent on the relative humidity, indicating that the sweat residue has low water content near the surface. Next, we will be studying about the application procedures of these powder. Before the application of powder formulation, the surface should be surged visually for the fingerprint impression. This is usually done with the aid of an intense light source in concert with a magnifying glass. The light source is put at an oblique angle to the surface suspected of bearing the latent finger mark and viewed with the help of a magnifying glass. The image here shows the equipment comprising of a magnifying glass and a light source for visual searching of possible latent print impressions. The print should first be photographed using an appropriate filter. Next, the relevant powder should be applied in a circular motion by a fingerprint brush. Generally, the fingerprint brush is made up of camel hair or from glass fiber. The image here shows a fingerprint brush. The most important thing to be noted here is that this brush can only be used with non-magnetic powders. Care should be taken to prevent the smudging of the imprint. Excess powder should then be removed off by dusting the surface with a gentle tapping or by blowing. The developed print should once again be photographed. Finally, it should be lifted with a tape and preserved for record. The figure shown on your screen shows how the developed print can be lifted by a tape. Application of powder to fingerprint by brushing is a well-established technique but has one disadvantage. contact of the brush with a fingerprint has an inevitable destructive effect, so that a degree of caution is required by the fingerprint expert. It has been estimated that about 10% of latent fingerprints developed at crime scenes using conventional powder dusting procedures are difficult to identify. Powder may be applied without using a brush. An electrostatic depositor, atomizer or aerosol spray may be used instead. The image here shows the electrostatic depositor for spraying a fingerprint powder. For electrostatic deposition, the powder is placed on the surface of an electrode held about 2.5 centimeters above the surface, impinged with the finger mark. A potential gradient of about 12 kilovolt is maintained between the electrode and the surface. The powder on the electrode becomes charged to the polarity of the electrode and is accelerated towards the surface, where it is discharged and acquires the polarity of the surface. The excess powder is attracted back to the electrode and is discharged there. Magna brushes and magna powders may also be used to avoid the problem of smudging. Magna powders are made by incorporating quartz spherical iron particles in the conventional powders. The magnetic iron acts as a carrier for the non-magnetic formulation, forming a brush when the powder is picked up with a magnetized applicator. On brushing the imprint impression, only the fine particles of the formulation adhere to the fingerprint residue. In simple terms, one can also say that the magnetic wand, when taken near the magnetic powder because of the creation of magnetic field, results in the formation of bristles at the tip of the wand, which acts as brush and can thus be directly used to develop the latent finger marks. Once the print has been developed, the excess powder can be detached from the applicator by withdrawing the magnetized steel rod. And in this first image shows a magna brush, and the second image on your screen shows a sample magna powder. To improve the performance of magnetic applicators, the magna powder can be replaced by magnetic flake particles also. In such formulations, the quartz iron particles are replaced by magnetic flakes that are attracted to magnetic applicator. Unlike standard magna powders, which contain only about 1% of fine particles that can adhere to the fingerprint residue, all the magnetic flakes lifted by the applicator are available for fingerprint development. The magnetic flakes are specifically useful for print development on rough and porous surfaces such as painted walls, polythene and paper. Our next module is on regular powders. Regular fingerprint powders consist of a resinous polymer for adhesion, that is for the sticking property, and a colorant for contrast. The adhesive gets adhered to the moisture and oily components of the sweat residue by pressure deficit mechanism that I have already explained to you, while the colorant or the colored particles gets adsorbed on the adhesive. In this manner, the rich pattern is visualized. The commonly used adhesives are starch, kaolin, rosin and silica gel. The colorant may be an inorganic salt or an organic derivative which imparts color to the ridges. Formulation containing ferric oxide and rosin, manganese dioxide and rosin, titanium and kaolin, lambac and Fuller's earth are some of the common examples of inorganic based fingerprint powders. The working performance of the composition may be improved by coating the powder onto fine quartz or plastic particulates. A black powder containing iron oxide, quartz, kaolin and carbon soot is an example of coated dusting formulation. Over the years, it became evident that commercial fingerprint powders containing inorganic salts of mercury, cadmium, titanium, lead, manganese, etc. pose an occupational hazard to the user. As a result, the organic-based formulations became more popular. These formulations generally contain an organic dye as a colorant. For improved results, fluorescent and laser-active dyes are used. Formulation containing fluorescein, eosine Y and rhodamine B are some of the common examples of organic-based fingerprint powders. These fluorescent powders works well with the ultraviolet light sources and multi-watt lasers. The main advantage of these powders is that they can be used on contrasting surfaces. They also come in magnetic and non-magnetic forms. These fluorescent powders react with the UV and purple or blue bands of visible light to produce different hues that can be easily detected. Care should be exercised by using colored goggles such that the wavelength of light emitted from the UV source does not harm the eyes. A sample fingerprint developed on glass by an eosine Y based powder is shown here in this image. Dear students, our next module after the regular powders is that of the metallic powders. Powder formulations containing meshed metals have been in use for a considerable time. Their advantage is that they have longer shelf life as compared to the organic based powders. Their disadvantage is that the metallic components elicit toxic effects to the users. Silver powder containing aluminum flake and quartz powder, gold powder containing bronze flake and powdered quartz, and grey powder containing meshed aluminum and kaolin are some of the examples of metallic dusting compositions. Further, fine lead powder has been used for latent detection with X-ray electronography and autoelectronography. A good number of powder formulations contain natural or synthetic organic derivatives that fluoresce or phosphoresce upon exposure to ultraviolet light or the laser light. The advantage of such compositions is that they are useful for visualization of latent prints deposited on multicolored surfaces that would present a contrast problem if developed with conventional powders. Moreover, these can be used for developing weak prints also. The disadvantage is that these can be rarely used in field work. The image here shows the fluorescent characteristics of a developed print. Some common organic compounds which have been used for powders are acridine yellow, acridine orange, coumarin 6, crystal violet, Nile blue, rhodamine B and rhodamine 6G. Luminescent powders containing lanthanide complexes in place of organic derivatives have also been formulated. Lanthanide complexes offer several advantages including benefits from large Stokes shift, long luminescence lifetimes, narrow emissions, ability of sequential assembly of complexes and chemical variability of ligands. Moreover, such powders are suitable for detection of latent fingerprints on difficult surfaces such as wood, masking tape and polythene. Now, dear students, let us conclude this lecture. Fingerprints are the distinctive ridges appearing as corrugated lines on the tips of fingers and thumbs. The pattern on each finger of a person is so unique that it is not repeated on another finger of the same person or on another fingers of any other person. This makes fingerprints the most infallible means of identification. Powder dusting is the simplest and most commonly used procedure for developing of the latent fingerprints. It is also the oldest technique to be used by fingerprint experts. It does not require any sophisticated equipment. Even an amateurish hand can develop the prints by brushing and tapping. The detection of prints may be carried out both at the scene of crime or in the laboratory. The adhesion of powder formulation to fingerprint residue is governed by the pressure deficit mechanism. If a powder particle is wetted only on its lower side by the sweat deposition, then owing to the curvature of meniscus, there will be a pressure deficit inside the droplet causing the particulate to adhere. The electrostatic attraction between the sweat residue and the powder particles resulting due to frictional charges also play a major role in adhesion, albeit a minor one. Above all, powder formulations are amenable to modification to suit the circumstances. Thus, it is possible to prepare powders which are cost-effective, non-toxic or luminescent in a wide array of particulate size, color and composition. With all these information here, we come to the end of today's lecture. Do keep in mind what we have discussed today. I will be back with one more lecture in this series. If you want to learn more and enhance your knowledge, you may log on to our website www.cec.nic.in for MCQs, quizzes, LORs, etc. Thank you for your time today. I will see you in the next lecture. Have a great day.